Latches and flip-flops are one of the most important components in digital applications. They can memorize digital states. Using millions of latches and flip-flops, we can develop processors, computers or smartphones as we know them today. So how do these latches work? What is the difference between SR and D latches? And what else do we have to consider when using such latches? Latches are so-called bistable multivibrators and have, as their name suggests, two stable states, usually high and low, with respect to the supply voltages. They can remain in these states for an arbitrarily long time. Therefore, these are suited for saving information by either being in one or the other state. We cover monostable and astable multivibrators in our other videos. To understand the concept of latches, let's start off with an inverter and another one. If we connect them in a loop, we get a structure that can save a high and a low value at the respective outputs of the inverters. But which output is high and which one is low? Well, that is not clearly defined and is depending on mainly two factors. The startup phase, when the voltages settle after switching on the power of the circuit, and the mismatch of the two inverters, which tells us how identical the inverters are. In order to prevent our inverters to make a random decision on the state they are in, we need some additional circuitry to set specific values for the structure. But how can we do so? Let's simply add two NMOS transistors to each of the inputs or outputs. One of the transistors receives a set signal and the other one a reset signal. We assume these transistors to be much stronger, so they have a much lower on resistance than the transistors of the inverters. In that way, they are able to pull either one of the nodes fully down to the negative supply voltage. Now, let's think about what happens by developing a truth table for the circuit. We have two inputs R and S and two outputs Q and Q bar. For R and S being zero, we can think of both NMOS as being turned off. This means that the state and therefore both outputs of the latch do not change. With other words, the previous state remains. If we now set a high value to S and keep R on low, this means that the input of the lower inverter is pulled down and therefore the output Q is going to a high state. By putting S to 1, we therefore set our output to 1. If we now set R to a high value and keep S on low, the output Q goes to low. In other words, we reset the output. If both inputs, R and S, are set to high, we have a not defined state, as both inputs and outputs are pulled down. This state is also called forbidden state, and the state of the structure is again depending on which transistors are stronger. With that, we've built our first latch and derived its truth table. This latch contains a set and a reset input and is therefore called SR latch, SR standing for set and reset. We can make another modification. We said that our set and reset transistors are way stronger than the PMOS transistors of the inverters, to properly pull the respective output down to the negative supply. However, we could do another trick by adding PMOS transistors to the positive supply of each of the inverters. These PMOS transistors are activated and deactivated by either the set or reset signals. By that, we deactivate the pull-up network and the pull-down network does not need to be much stronger anymore. If you want to know more on pull-up and pull-down networks, please have a look at our other video on CMOS circuits. Now let's take a closer look at these 8 transistors that we use in the SR latch. We can see that 4 transistors each form a NOR gate, so we are left with a simplified representation. We therefore only need 2 NOR gates for our SR latch. We again want to deduce the truth table for this representation. Therefore, we first assume that R, S and Q are low. If R and S are low, The outputs Q and Q bar do not change. They remain the same. If S is high, we see that Q becomes high and Q bar becomes low. If R is high, we see that Q becomes low and Q bar becomes high. If R and S are both high, we are again in the forbidden state. We can also build an SR latch with a similar behavior by using NAND gates. In this case, the outputs and inputs need to be inverted to keep the exact same behavior. We will see the advantage of this circuit in a few moments. We can introduce inverters before each of the inputs to recreate the behavior of the NOR gates. Instead of an inverter, we could also add another two NAND gates and introduce an additional control signal that we will call C. This signal C acts as a clock. If it is high, then the set and the reset signal can propagate through the two NANDs. In this way, we have built a clocked SR latch. We can even do another modification by adding an inverter in between the set and reset signals. Thereby, we can avoid the forbidden state. What we have created now is called D-latch, where the D stands for data. Let us again have a look at the truth table. As long as the control signal is high, the output is equal to the input. If the control signal is zero, the last state of the latch is saved and the input D does not have any influence on the output. Let's conclude our video about latches. We showed how two inverters can save a digital state. We built a simple SR latch from two inverters and extended it step by step. Finally, we developed a D-latch. Based on these D-latch structures, we will investigate flip-flop structures in one of our other videos. I'm Dominik with the Institute of Electronics. We hope you have learned something today, but anyway, thanks for watching.